As I said, my tip is to only store working machines away. I quickly want to do the NVRAM of this. By now you have seen the Dallas NVRAM for the 386, as well as the ST NVRAM of the Spark Station 2 or IPX. This one is similar to the IPX one, just slightly newer. So we do only a very brief, less introductory director's cut of that. Actually, the power supply is pretty warm for the machine being switched off, so you probably don't want to leave them in standby if they consume that much standby electricity. So NVRAM is here. I had it out the other day when I had to reset the Ultra 5. Looks like I pressed it more hard in than it was. Not that we bent the pins here. So this is also an ST. As far as I remember from the Ultra 5, this was to drill also at here at the end. Actually, no, I took it out. That was not the most clever, but okay. Probably at least have a video to check this time, but it probably was here. Not that I installed it the wrong way. Alright, I think it should be like this. The markings matching there. What's the camera not rolling? So opposite of the first pin here on the side. Eventually you will hit the small shiny spots, which are the battery connectors, and you can also measure the remaining capacity, but solder then the battery wires to that. So this one I drilled a little bit more open. The very first one I did was off camera for the Ultra 5 quite some months ago. Well, the second was probably the Spark Station 2 that I unfortunately destroyed. Then came the Dallas of the 386. And the very first one from the Ultra 5, I did not disconnect the battery. So on this terminals, here is internally the battery connected. So on the second one I wanted to do for this, the range of Ultra Sparks is to also disconnect the battery here. So I will measure now the voltage and resistance. And then we, unlike my first one I did for testing, where I still have to do this, on this one I want to drill through here to disconnect the internal battery to avoid our retrofitted battery leaking electrons into the built-in battery and thus overly discharging the battery we will attach. So each time perfecting the procedure. So I think left is ground, right is positive. And maybe we have some 0.3 volt left here. And now I will drill through and measure to make sure that we really disconnect its internal battery. I think you feel when you drill through metal, this epoxy stuff is very soft, so there's only one hard spot that should be the metal connection. So as with the other ones, I snap here these plastic noses off that they fit better on the NVRAM for gluing it down here. And I will probably also look for other ones, because on this one I don't like how hard the battery is to get in and out here. Not that you do it often, but as we have the choice, I probably try to find better stock for the future. So today I will first glue it, then solder it. Minus is left, minus is here. And let it rest for a bit in the hope that for better results, and let's see if the date becomes strange again. So today I will let it rest like this, and then we see if the results are better, or again if this epoxy stuff becomes strange with this second drying glue stuff here. So without moving it, I think it looks much better than the last time. So maybe that was only moving it quickly, though here it could look slightly more perfect. I'm also not sure if this stuff, I actually don't use it so often, and I will certainly buy this hot glue gun anyway, because I'm also not sure if the last time the battery was really quickly empty in a minute or so. So maybe this stuff is electricity conducting, and when I soldered it here, electrons flew through this glue, which may also have caused this strange color and structure. Anyway, so minus was here. By the way, this carrier thing, how big is it there? Okay, there. Oh shit, the battery does not. Maybe I should have checked this earlier. Huh? Okay, could press it in there though. And we solder it very much to the top. Are we running here? You actually want to make sure not to solder your drill through battery contacts, to close them with solder again. So as you can see, just fits in there. There's even on this one, this PCB silk screen layer indicates the way it should be plugged in with this smaller and bigger handle, I think. So this looks like it fits quite nicely. So let's plug it in and see how this programming goes, that it survived and keeps the time. As you can see, I unpacked the Ultra 5 again, because the Ultra 30 caps lock or so was flashing erratically. Maybe that was only the post, we will see in a minute. So I have the new flash, you see this is the Ultra 5 flash with a bigger battery. I have the new flash in there. So let's quickly program it and see if it works here. But here's this NVRAM stuff. Apparently it's not for the light-hearted people to do. Maybe it works, huh? Let's see. We also should have another MAC address though eventually. So let me put in another one. So this mkpl function only works as far as I know when the checksum is invalid. So I first invalidated the checksum, then run this with some slightly modified values, checked it here. If this mkpl doesn't print a copyright string, it was successful. If it prints a copyright string, it was unsuccessful. And yeah, so it looks at least for the moment that it works on this one. And then let's move it over to the Ultra 30 and hope that works as well. Okay, that indeed looks better. And better, but no keyboard. At least it has the Ethernet address, and also, of course, the machine ID doesn't match. Okay, now the keyboard was at least blinking. Maybe it was not all the way in. So it turns out there are some more key combinations I didn't know. So stop N, powering the machine on, resets it to defaults, and just pressing stop skips the post test. Not yet sure what's up with this machine. I hope only the post test takes very long. I now booted with stop N for defaults, and I reprogrammed here the content we want to have. And I guess let's see if it restarts by itself. I forgot to turn off the DX switch. Anyway, the NVRAM is not totally dead, and actually I hope it's okay. Yeah, okay, now it's coming back. It's really nice to have this fully functional, scriptable and programmable open firmware. Even the modern graphical PC AFI biases get a little bit on my nerves with this fluffy graphic nonsense, and here you can type and program what exactly you want. So after the first shock here aside, somehow it's always a little bit of a drama with this NVRAM. Also because the machines behave slightly different, and maybe this post test takes forever, whatever, but okay, we had this, so now this is gone, and actually we could continue booting disk and set the date and reboot and see if the date is there. So let's set the date and reboot. Even if we don't love Apple anymore, we can still use our NTP server. There's always something with bugs and regressions. But anyway, so that's it for today. It looks like we saved another NVRAM, and I hope you learned something. Don't forget to share, like and subscribe, and I hope to see you soon. Actually, it did work now. Maybe this error was only reading the hardware time that was 0 or FFF, but nonetheless it looks like we may have a time now. As well, there's also some high pitch noise going on there. Some sounds to me to some Unix core whine. Wonder why the data shown so strange there. Been best just to check the data. I don't want to fully boot. I want to switch it off and actually need to rush to an appointment now. So date and time is there, so I guess we can fully call this a success and hopefully soon run out of NVRAMs that we need to drill in and solder better on. So stay tuned for more thrilling content next.